My name is Thundering Woman. I'm from the Bear Clan. I want to welcome you all to my homeland, where our Anishinaabes have lived since time immemorial. The Anishinaabes have made treaties across the lands in good faith and spirit, that we would share this land among our visitors. We have never surrendered our homelands. It was to share, which are written in the treaties. I am a descendant of Treaty 1. This is Treaty 1 territory, and this treaty was done in ceremony, and so that we still honor the treaty that making process, which happened over 100 years ago, the very first treaty that was signed just outside of Winnipeg. So you're all sitting in Treaty 1 territory of the Anishinaabes. So we have a responsibility as peoples of those treaties to honor our ancestors and to live to the treaty as settlers and Indigenous people, to maintain honor in our relationships for the sake of the lands and waters and the future generations to come. I prepared a little something to introduce this very important issue of water and the urgency in protecting this very life-giving source for all that know its sacredness. There are times the water is taken for granted, that the water will be around and safe for all for many years. Many years ago, there was a water summit held here in Winnipeg in the mid-90s. And they were discussing the future of the water and the plans of the waters, that it will be a commodity and there will be wars for the waters. And the industries will prevail and contaminate where it will be unusable. I remember they asked who I represented, and I replied to them, I'm a mother, I represent my children. I wasn't an NGO. I wasn't part of any environmental organization. So I wasn't important enough. But I got through one of the organizers who knew of my passion for Indigenous people and their rights. I believe that as a mother, we have certain responsibilities to protect from any harm of our children. And as a mother, I took that sacred vow to protect my babies from any harm. And I believed I had to be there to educate myself so I can protect the future and the waters that are also very dependent. They're very dependent on. Today, my whole family is in protecting our sacred waters for all life, which includes your lives, your family's lives. We are on the front lines trying to stop the big greedy corporations from further harm on the lands and waters. And yet we are demonized as Indigenous people by the media, so the rest of mainstream can act out in hatred and violence towards us as Indigenous people. When we're on the front lines or speaking against industry and destruction on our homelands, we need you. We need you on the front lines and allies. And as allies standing next to us, as we are stronger together than apart on this issue of protection of the land and water. We have, as Indigenous people, have always had a respect for the land and the waters that have sustained us for thousands of years, as it is in a very much part of our ceremonies, which the water and our Mother Earth are included in our prayers, as they are spirits that come to continue to help us on our daily walk. We have a relationship that is none like others. We are of this land where our Creator has placed us. In our songs, our ceremonies, our oral stories, our territorial landmarks, which we still use since time immemorial, separating of the other nations who we share this land with. Our DNA is part of this land, so we know these lands and waters intimately that still provide for us. We still hunt, gather our medicines, our fishing, which is so much part of who we are as Indigenous people. These lands have been our kitchen, where it stores our food, our pharmacy, where it stores our medicines, our waters, our life-giving force, our source for all life used with our food and medicines. Industry and greedy corporations have come onto our homelands without permission to extract, to build pipelines and other destructive, extracting dangerous machinery and practices to destroy and endanger our future of safe, clean waters and further displace us from our homelands. once again forgetting that Indigenous people and the visitors, settlers still use this lands and waters for our daily survival. This is an ongoing concern, and that many mainstream population have no idea of the relationship that we still have as Indigenous people, that it still provides for us as it did for thousands of years. Settler people have had the privilege of living off our homelands that has also provided for their families, and as settlers of this land, it's time for them to help in protection of these lands and waters to make sure that their future is also safe for all. For if we fail to exist as Indigenous people on our homeland, so do you fail to exist, cease to exist, for we have known how to live off the lands for thousands of years. It's time to work together as allies to stop these monsters from harming and destroying our future. We need to put our personalisms and our beliefs aside for the sake and survival of our children, our grandchildren, and future generations. We need to come together for the sake of humanity and all life, where we share the lands and waters with each other. Chimiigwech, for the opportunity to welcome you into my territory, and I hope you have a great panel. Miigwech.
Thank you so much for that important welcome and those very important words. I want to welcome everybody for coming here tonight. Absolutely wonderful to see a full crowd here. And what we're here to talk about tonight is TransCanada's Energy East Pipeline. And I think we've got a really amazing panel of people bringing a lot of different knowledge, different experiences, and information that's really critical for communities like this one that are directly on the path of the pipeline, but really for all of us that have a stake in what's happening with this particular pipeline project. So before we get rolling, I'll introduce myself. My name's Andrea Harden-Donahue. I'm energy and climate campaigner with the Council of Canadians. And this stop here in Winnipeg is the first of four stops we're doing on a tour on the Energy East Pipeline along the path in the prairies. Next, we're off to, tomorrow we're in Shoal Lake 39 and Shoal Lake 40, and then we're off to Regina and Swift Current and Moose Jaw. And this comes after doing a six community tour along the pipeline path in Ontario, as well as visiting pipeline path communities in New Brunswick and Bay of Fundy. And when we do these tours, this particular tour, we've worked with the National Farmers Union on, and we also work with local partners. So I just want to make sure everybody knows here tonight, big thank you for the support and the amazing organizing happening here in this community, Grassroots Indigenous Water Defense, Manitoba Energy Justice Coalition, Wilderness Committee, 350 Boreal Action Project, and the University of Winnipeg Students Union. A number of them have information at the back. I do encourage you to go back and collect that information and do seek out and go to these communities who are organizing on this important issue. So the Council of Canadians, we're working on this Energy East Pipeline, and we really strongly feel it's all risk and little reward. There's a number of risks that we identify, and I'm going to leave most of that for these speakers here to bring up. And we also challenge the benefits that are proposed with the project. So I'm going to start by giving you some of the basic information to make sure we're all on the same page of what this actually is that we're talking about. So to start, TransCanada is the company behind this Energy East Pipeline. It's proposing a 4,400 kilometer pipeline from Alberta to St. John, New Brunswick. Through the prairies, it would see the conversion of an existing natural gas pipeline that this company already owns. So that particular pipeline is around 43 years old throughout most of the prairies. And then we're also going to see a conversion of the pipeline in Ontario to a place called Cornwall, close to where I live. I'm from Ottawa. And from there on in, it's new pipeline all the way crossing the St. Lawrence, following the St. Lawrence to St. John, New Brunswick. And this port at St. John, New Brunswick, it's beside a really beautiful coastal community called Redhead, and we're actually working with people there. We're quite concerned about this. That port will have the capacity to export 1.1 to 2.2 million barrels of crude pretty much every day. So one of the things that Maude will talk about is really how this is an export pipeline. The project is also going to see 72 pumping stations, and what those are used for is to continue the flow of the pipeline, continue the flow of the oil through the pipeline. And they actually require a lot of electricity, which is something to keep an eye on here in this province. It was brought to my attention that one of the new dams, 40 to 50% of the power generated from that dam would likely go to powering this and another pipeline. And in fact, the price being paid by the company for using that is about half of what you Manitobans pay for the same power. So let's get rolling here. Perfect. That first one, you can go past Chris. Yeah, we don't need Skype right now. We use Skype a lot in organizing circles. So that's just a rough idea of where the pipeline goes. If you want a more detailed map, thanks TransCanada for the one we printed off back there. So one of the things I want to talk about is this 1.1 million barrels per day. First of all, it's a multi-use pipeline, so that means it'll carry a slate of crude. So it can carry back and fracked crude. That's what exploded in the tragedy in Lac Mégantic. It can do conventional crude produced in Alberta. It can ship heavy oil. It can ship diluted bitumen produced in the tar sands. A large portion of it, and very much a growing portion of it, will be diluted bitumen from the tar sands. And with this pipeline, one thing we want to emphasize is the sheer size of it, and this infographic, I don't know how well you can see it from back there, captures this a little bit. So energies, 1.1 million barrels per day. That's about the Northern Gateway Pipeline project, which effectively is not going to move forward because of the resistance it's facing in BC, frankly. It's about half of the capacity of this pipeline. Keystone XL, which I'm convinced they're going to stop in the US too, and we'll hear from Ben on that. It's about 830,000 barrels per day. So this is the largest tar sands pipeline proposed to date. An important thing to know in understanding what you're facing. And in terms of this particular pipeline project, in terms of the timeline, they've filed with the National Energy Board, and they filed their application. A whole bunch of people, over 2,000 people applied to intervene despite the very limited access we have to that now due to changes that came about under the Harper government. And normally what happens is a 15-month timeline starts once the NEB decides the application is complete. That hasn't happened yet, and we have good reason to believe that that application absolutely is not complete. There's a number of reasons, but the one I want to highlight here is opposition to energy eats absolutely is widespread, and it's growing, and it had its first victory. And despite what TransCanada says, the cancelling of the Kakuna port beside an endangered beluga whale habitat, that was a win for grassroots activists, for environmental activists, for people. There is no reason that they canceled that other than the widespread opposition that faced that. And Quebec opposition, in fact, the vast majority of people in that province opposed this project. And that port, there was no way for that port to go. But so that has actually resulted in the entire timeline for this project being moved back. The operational date proposed for the project to flow, the pipeline to flow, was 2018. Now it's 2020. And certainly we're waiting to hear from the National Energy Board what this means for the actual hearing process and the timeline. We absolutely feel that TransCanada should be set back to the drawing board at this point, that their application is not complete. And we, for one, and I know many others fighting this, will push for that strongly. So we're going to hear a lot about one of the main risks that people feel and see with this project, and that's pipeline spills. And I want to leave the where and the frequency and the what it would spill to our speakers here, but one thing I kind of wanted to fill in is a little bit on another piece that oftentimes gets left out of the equation. You think about where the pipeline spills, when it's going to spill, but the other thing that we think is critical to evaluate is this particular company's safety track record. So we shouldn't just be looking at what they're saying for this project and what they're filing, but what they've actually done, particularly here in Canada. So when we started investigating this, we became increasingly concerned about this project and TransCanada having a major tar sands pipeline in Canada. So we actually found out between 1992 and now, TransCanada has had more ruptures in Canada than any other pipeline company, according to statistics available through the National Energy Board. We found out in the past 16 months alone, TransCanada has had 4 major ruptures on their North American pipelines. And in reviewing, in reviewing the mainline system, this is a system of natural gas pipelines. They want to convert one of them for this project. So we took a look at the pipeline safety report. So when a rupture happens, this big report gets done by the government. So we went through and read all of those, and we found some really interesting things. TransCanada talks a lot about the importance of early leak detection. What we found out was that one, arguably two, of these pipeline ruptures was discovered by the electronic leak system. The rest were discovered by passerbys. Some were discovered by TransCanada staff. One was discovered by an OPP officer driving down the highway and seeing a huge massive ball of flame. That's how these pipeline ruptures were found. We also found out stress corrosion and cracking is the main cause of these ruptures, and that in terms of isolating the flow of gas to the pipelines, one was 7 minutes, that's pretty good. One was 3 hours and 30 minutes, not so good. One was 7 hours. The sheer capacity of this pipeline, 1.1 million barrels per day, means that when it spills, and it will spill, it threatens to be the largest pipeline spill Canada has ever seen. And in terms of understanding the leak detection system, that same one that I was talking about didn't trigger in these, it actually won't recognize a spill that's less than 1.5% of the capacity of the pipeline. So that means 2.64 million liters of crude per day could leak and not trigger a signal with this system. And that comes out of a report commissioned by Quebec municipality trying to better understand the risks with this project. I want to just briefly highlight, we've had 2 whistleblowers come forward who used to work with TransCanada. One of them is Evan Vokes, and I'm just going to read this here. TransCanada Pipeline has a culture of non-compliance and deeply entrenched business practices that ignore the legally required regulations and code. The mix of political and commercial interests allow industry to claim they exceed federal requirements when they are building substandard pipelines with no enforcement or accountability in the process. He was the first whistleblower to come forward. Now we have a second whistleblower that has come forward. I encourage you to take a look online and read the Reuters investigation about this. Now we even have the pipeline investigators at the NEB under investigation by the Engineering Society for their review of this particular pipeline. I just want to highlight briefly too, one of the other key risks we see with this pipeline is what it means upstream, what filling this pipeline means. And what it means is 30 to 32 million tons, sorry, am I getting that right? Yes, 30 to 32 million tons of climate pollution is produced annually, and that's a pretty dry figure, but let's put it this way, that's more pollution than the entire province of Manitoba produces in a year. It's more than any Atlantic province. It's the equivalent of adding about 7 million cars to the road. So when we're talking about the capacity of this pipeline, filling it also has a massive climate pollution impact, which should be particularly relevant today when we just saw more than 25,000 people hit the streets in Quebec City ahead of a premier's meeting there this week on climate change to send a very clear message that premiers can act on climate or they can improve pipelines like this and allow tar sands expansion, because believe us, there's a new report out on it. There's every statistic shows this very clearly. Meeting even our meager, frankly, targets on climate is completely incompatible with any one of these pipelines coming forward and being approved and filling that pipeline. It is absolutely incompatible. When we're talking about expanding the tar sands, industry wants to see a tripling of it by 2030. They've downcasted that by about 300,000 barrels per day with dropping oil prices. The reality is they still absolutely do want to expand. 5 million barrels per day is already approved. 2 million barrels per day is what's being produced right now. So that gap between what is already being produced and what is already approved is what they want to move forward with. And frankly, the capacity they have to get it out of Alberta right now is coming to its limits, which is why for industry, these pipeline projects are actually really critical. And I want to finish quickly by addressing something. So won't this oil be produced anyways and shipped by rail? That's something we've been hearing a lot of lately. And I'm actually going to let Maude address that, but frankly, we don't think it's an either-or situation. I'm going to leave it there for now. Finally, in terms of a key benefit that's being proposed, the economic benefits, the jobs, I would highlight, and it's, I wish we could talk, there's so many things we can talk about this pipeline here. I wish we could talk about this one more, but I would, those of you that are interested in this, take a look at a new report written by the Mowat Center for the Ontario Energy Board on this pipeline, and what they concluded is the promises for jobs is likely overblown. And in fact, they said it's not clear from the application whether some of the jobs that they're saying will happen in Ontario are new jobs or whether it's actually taking people currently working on the pipeline for the natural gas pipeline and just switching them over to oil. There are things like that. That's actually a track record that this company has in terms of overblowing their promises that Ben can speak to. So, and at this point in time, the reality is, I want to go to the final slide. Nope, there we go. This is actually a really critical point to keep in mind when we talk about all of this. For every million invested, 2 jobs in oil and gas, 15 in clean energy. We need to bear that in mind when we're making the sort of decision about a project like this that's supposed to allow oil to flow through it for the next 40 years. So I'd like to take the opportunity now to introduce Benjamin Gotschall, and we're so happy he's here on this trip for us. He came with us once before when we were on our Atlantic tour. He's born and raised on a cattle ranch in the sand hills of southwest Holt Country, Nebraska. And although most of his occupations have been agricultural, he's also published full-length book of poetry and taught college English. He continues to maintain a connection to the sand hills by marketing his family's grass-fed beef while also running his own operation, Davy Road Ranch in Raymond. He operates a dairy cattle business called Holt Creek Jerseys and is currently a dairy manager at Branched Oak Farm in Raymond. And he is the energy director of Bold Nebraska. So please welcome Ben.
Thank you all for being here tonight. And I've said it everywhere I've gone in Canada before, and I'll say it again tonight because it's true. If we have this many people at our initial meetings in Nebraska, in the US, Keystone XL would never have seen the light of day in 2012. And so today I was walking down by the Forks, which is a beautiful area here in your city, and I was admiring your beautiful human rights museum that you have there, and it reminded me of a quote by one of our great human rights leaders, Dr. Martin Luther King, who said that a threat to justice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. And I think that you could take the word justice and substitute any other word in there, but tonight I'm going to use the word water. And when I first came to this fight several years ago, that was my main concern, was my drinking water. And over time, my thinking about this issue has progressed. And so what originally for me was a not in my backyard issue has become a not on planet Earth issue. And so I've transitioned from NIMBY to NOPE, and hopefully that's what President Obama will say about the Keystone XL pipeline permit in our country soon. So next slide, please. Just a little bit about where I'm from and what brought me to this fight. Our ranch where I grew up, and most of Nebraska actually, is situated above the Northern High Plains Aquifer System, commonly known as the Ogallala Aquifer. It supplies a significant amount of drinking water for our state and for the United States. It underlies several of our states in the middle of our country. It provides 30% of the irrigation water for the U.S., not for Nebraska, for the United States. And 30% of the world's groundwater is, freshwater is groundwater, and according to some studies and that are actually quite alarming, in about 15 years, almost half of the world will face water shortages. And half the world's people will live in areas of high water stress. And so if you think that oil is a valuable commodity, think about what water will be worth then. Next slide, please. Our agricultural economy depends on the aquifer, We need water to water our cattle. We need water to drink. We need water to irrigate our crops. We are the number one state in the United States for irrigated cropland acres. We are the number one state in the United States for commercial red meat production. Next slide. Just some numbers there for the numbers folks. When TransCanada came to us and was talking about their $7 billion pipeline, we looked at it and said, yeah, but what about our $22 billion agriculture economy? How is it going to affect that if you contaminate our groundwater that we depend on for irrigation? And what are you going to do about the 3 out of 4 people in Nebraska whose livelihood depends on agriculture? You want to talk about jobs? You got to talk about agriculture if you're going to talk about that in our state. And so we came at it from a very different perspective of, we don't need a pipeline to come into our state. We don't need a foreign corporation to come into our state and tell us what's good for us. We've got a good thing going here and we want to protect it. We have abundant natural resources and we want to keep it that way. Next slide, please. And so basically my philosophy was, why risk any part of it? This map here shows Nebraska. The blue part is the Ogallala Aquifer. The purple line is the first route of the Keystone XL, which has since been rerouted. That part where the black label is pointing is right about where my family's ranch is. Hackinson was my hometown. That particular area there is what's known as the recharge zone of the aquifer, where there's no separation between surface water and groundwater. You can literally hit water digging a fence post hole. There have been summers where you could paddle a canoe across our hay meadows. So there's a connection between surface water and groundwater that is not, it's unbreakable. And so any type of contamination in either of those things is very, very dangerous to a very susceptible portion of our drinking water system. Overlying a significant portion of our state is the Nebraska Sandhills, where I grew up. It's the largest vegetated sand dune area in the Western Hemisphere. It's very susceptible to wind erosion. It's very permeable soils. I mean, when you say it's sand hills, it is sand hills. And I know that you folks up here have some ecosystems like that. So some of you are nodding like you understand. You know what happens when you spill something in sand, whether it's water or anything else. It goes down, and it goes down fast, and it moves quickly. And so that's why we were very concerned about the possibility of a pipeline pumping 800,000 barrels of oil a day. And we didn't believe TransCanada when they said, oh, if it spills, it'll only be about a dozen barrels before we catch it and clean it up. Well, when you do the math on 800,000 barrels per day, how many barrels of that is pumping through there every minute? They're not gonna detect that, find it, stop it in less than a second. I can guarantee you that, because they never have and they never will. And so we didn't believe what they were saying. And this is a slide that kind of illustrates, in where I'm from, we don't dig wells. We pound a pipe into the ground and water comes out of it. And so this is what we call a flowing well on our ranch. Our ranch has dozens of them. Most of the ranches in that region have, depending on the size of the ranch, anywhere from a dozen to 100. And they flow perpetually unless you put a shutoff valve on or a float, which we do sometimes. And they make these little marshes where the water percolates back down into the groundwater or runs into a drainage stream where it percolates and catches in a pond or something. And we can drink directly from that. There's no electricity required to pump it. It's clean, filtered, very pure water, some of the best water in the country, some of the best water in the world. And growing up, my dad always told me, he said, you know, you might not think so now, but you will see people and you will meet people and you will see places where they won't believe you that you have this. And so he always told me, what we have here is worth more than money. And I always thought about that growing up, and then, you know, when I heard about this pipeline, I kind of realized that it was true. So just a quick illustration of the sand hills. This is an area that was disturbed by our public power district to provide power for a pumping station. This is before TransCanada had a permit to build the pipeline, and they still don't, by the way. Not in our state, not in South Dakota, not in the United States. You can see what can quickly happen. That's an area about the size of 2 football fields originally, and you can see on the edges where it's spreading. Next slide. That down at the bottom is a county highway. Up to the top left is what used to be my brother's house. He moved away from there. He was kind of sick of it. Next slide. And then that's the town nearby where he used to live. So any type of damage to the land itself can quickly spread. And so these are some of the concerns that I had early on. We always knew that we could do better. I talked about our ag economy. We also have the potential to create significant amounts of jobs in the renewable energy field. We're third in the country in wind energy potential, but we're kind of in the bottom half for what we've actually done. We still rely heavily on coal power to provide our electricity, and if we were to make a transition, which we're slowly starting to do, but we could do more quickly, we have a huge potential to create lots and lots and lots of good-paying, permanent, long-term, sustainable jobs in our state. Solar, we're pretty much the same. We're in the top of our states as far as what we could do, but we're pitifully low and down toward the bottom of what we've actually done. And same thing with efficiency. Per capita, we spend a lot of money per capita on electricity. Coal is not cheap anymore, and it's not getting cheaper. And yet we literally do little, next to nothing to make our homes and our businesses more efficient. If we were to invest money in those types of things, we wouldn't even need to discuss a pipeline. Next. So this was the first ad, and I say ad because our media was not interested in covering the story of the pipeline. They, like TransCanada, like our local leaders who had been visited by TransCanada, said this pipeline is a done deal. It's inevitable. You're not going to stop it. It's not a story. It's not news. So we had to go around. I was asking leaders of some of the state environmental organizations for money to buy an ad. And luckily, I ran across this woman named Jane Klebb, who had just started this little organization called Bold Nebraska. And I said, you know, this pipeline thing is important to our state. And do you think you could, you know, maybe give me some money so we could buy an ad to let people know that we're having a hearing about this in our state? And she said, sure, but you have to be in the ad and you have to provide a quote. And so I agreed to do that. You can't see the quote, but basically I said something like, this was at the time of the BP spill in the Gulf of Mexico. You know, we shouldn't use this spill in the Gulf of Mexico as an excuse to build more fossil fuel infrastructure that could potentially pollute our water. We should use it as a sign, as a clear indication that we need to move away from those types of energy and do something different and protect the natural resources that we have. And so we got a lot of people to our initial State Department hearings. This is one of my favorite quotes, all politics is local. We got involved in local politics. We had people who had never even so much as written a letter to the editor, even people who had never even voted, coming out and speaking on behalf of their land and their water. In this photo on the left is my boss, Jane Klebb. The second guy is Marty Cobanese with the Indigenous Environmental Network, who work with the tribes. The third guy is a guy named Graham Christensen with the Nebraska Farmers Union. So we started working together. We started forming coalitions of organizations and of people and of communities, and we got people to come out. We started running our own media campaigns, telling our own stories, because our farmers and ranchers and you folks here in your own community, you're the experts about this area. And it's great if you have local experts, scientists, hydrogeologists, folks that know the numbers and know the technical things to tell you you know what the risks are, but you know what they are. You live here. Don't let anyone tell you that you don't have the authority on what's good for you and your community, because you do. And so we did that. We had, in a town of about 1,300 people, we had over 3,000 people come to the hearing. So they weren't just coming from that area. They were coming from all over the state. 90% of the speakers that spoke at those hearings were opposed to the pipeline. We were keeping track. We kept the pressure on President Obama, who did deny the permit for the Keystone Pipeline in early 2012, and he cited concerns in Nebraska. We had problems with the route in Nebraska because it went through the Sandhills and the Ogallala Aquifer. For 4 years, TransCanada told us that it was impossible that they could not move the route away from the sandhills, away from the aquifer. And the day after President Obama denied the permit, they came out with a new route and said, oh, well, we're gonna accommodate your wishes, and we're going to move our pipeline route to address your concerns. Sometimes when you work at a local level and you organize and you build resistance, you can get the attention of your national leaders, and that's what you can do, and that's what you have to do in order to stop, in order to influence a project of this magnitude. We kept the pressure on President Obama. We invited him to our communities. We ran campaigns, postcard campaigns. Every event we went to, we asked folks to write postcards and letters to President Obama and take pictures to send to him. We didn't just keep the focus on our own government. There in the photo is my friend Megan Hammond. She's a cattle rancher and corn farmer down in central Nebraska. We're very much aware that this is a global issue. This is an international issue. This is a North America issue. And it's not just our leaders who are on the hook here. It's yours as well. And so we welcome your help and your support in challenging those people, because they need to be challenged. They're not used to it. They might not like it, but they need it, just like anybody else who is used to getting what they want most of the time. We challenged our governor. This is in our legislative chamber during our governor's State of the State address. We had some young ladies who got creative with their wardrobe. It's illegal to take placards and signs into the state house. So they sent him a message about it says, Governor Heineman, don't turn your back on the aquifer. And so we did things like that. We also started an organization called NEAT, the Nebraska Easement Action Team, because the landowners are a very, very important part of this whole process. They are the folks who are being asked, being told, being forced to give up their property, to give up the actual physical space and land to build these projects. And so we decided soon after the new route had been identified that we needed to organize the landowners. And so we formed NEAT, and we realized very early on that it's very, very important what the easements actually say, what the agreements that the landowners have signed or will sign with TransCanada, or would refuse to sign in our case, what those actually say. Because when it comes to keeping a company accountable, nothing will do it unless it's written on paper. And so they can promise you this, they can promise you that, they can try to persuade you and ease your concerns, they can give you gifts, they can give you money, they can take you out for a steak dinner, but if it doesn't say it in the easement, it will not happen. And so it frankly alarms me that here in this area, TransCanada is arguing that 40, 50, I don't know, 60-year-old easements for natural gas pipelines somehow magically now apply to tar sands crude oil pipelines. That to me makes no sense. That's a violation of property rights, and you should be fighting for your landowners' rights, because that's Canadian property, and that belongs to the people. The landowners might own it and they might control it, but really it belongs to all of you. And so if you allow them to violate those property rights and those landowners' rights, where are you going to stop? How much are you going to let them take? What are you going to let them do to your land? And so it takes a lot of courage to stand up to them and say, hey, we will not sign an easement with you. We will not agree to your terms, because the terms are what's most important, not the money. They'll try to distract you with money. They'll try to make you think about price, but it's a distraction. You have to know what those easements say, what they mean, and what that means for the future and for the people who will be living on that land in 50 or 100 years from now. No eminent domain for private gain was a campaign we ran with NEAT. We ran billboards. That there is Susan Donovan, who is one of the landowners who sued the state of Nebraska over the law that gave that made the pipeline route in Nebraska and won. And then we also came together as a community and built a barn in the path of the pipeline that is powered by solar and wind power. Over 1,000 people came together over 2 weekends and was built with all volunteer labor, and over 10,000 people donated money to pay for it. And so if President Obama were to approve the pipeline permit, which We hope he doesn't. They would literally have to tear down clean energy in order to build that pipeline. And so it brought people together. It gave us something physical to see. And so now our little barn is generating electricity back onto the public power grid, and we can safely say that we've produced more energy in Nebraska than TransCanada ever will. We also began to form new alliances and work with the tribes, because we could see that a lot of the concerns that the native tribes had with the pipeline were the same concerns that our farmers and ranchers had. And it wasn't a matter of what they could do for us or what we could do for them. It was a matter of what we could do together to stop the pipeline and to stop the blatant violation of treaty rights, of property rights, and of human rights that we were seeing in our communities and in their communities as well. And so we formed what we call the new CIA, the Cowboy Indian Alliance. And we had several events in South Dakota, in Nebraska. And we marched on Washington. We set up an encampment in the Capitol. We rode horses down the streets of Washington. We set up teepees in the National Mall. And we occupied that space to get that message out that we were working together and we were standing strong in the middle of our country. Those are just some more images that we used. The guy up on the top left is a really cool guy. His name's Art Tandrup. He has a farm in Antelope County, Nebraska. And Art's farm, and that's the flag that we fly above all of our events. The tribes in South Dakota call the pipeline the Black Snake. And with the tribes, we have implemented a strategy to cut off the head and cut off the tail and cut into pieces the Black Snake, because in South Dakota now, they do not have a permit to build that pipeline. It expired. And now the four tribes have filed as interveners in that process to get that permit, as well as Bold Nebraska, as well as individual ranchers. And in Nebraska, we've sued the state of Nebraska over our unconstitutional pipeline laws, and we've stopped TransCanada from using eminent domain in our state by using citizens' power, standing up for citizens' rights. So on Art's farm, On Art's farm, we also constructed the world's largest crop art. That's an 80-acre cornfield that was done by an artist using a tractor and a disc. And also on Art's farm, the Ponca tribe, which was relocated to Oklahoma, the Ponca tribe came back and planted on that land that was their traditional homeland, their sacred corn that they hadn't grown in their homeland for 137 years. And so we've done other things like march in New York for the People's Climate March. We've marched in Washington. If you can't see the sign on the bottom right, it says, "Standing in this water could get me arrested. TransCanada pollutes water and nothing happens." We also had a concert out on Art's cornfield with one of my favorite Canadians, Neil Young, and his buddy, Willie Nelson. Over 10,000 people came, closer to 15,000. It was a all-day event that incorporated local Nebraska music, Neil and Willie, and tribal musicians. And we also do voting campaigns where we target pro-pipeline senators and congressmen, and we vote them out of office. And I know that you've in some of your provinces up here, you've been able to do the same thing, and I congratulate you for that, and you need to do more of it. And more people like you folks in this room need to run for those offices, because it's important. And so we've had some victories in Nebraska, and I think that you will have some victories here if you continue to work together, educate your neighbors, educate your friends and family, listen to each other, work together, and hopefully that's about as close as I ever got to the president in this whole thing. But I'm holding out hope that he will protect the water in our country and will make the right decision. And so again, thank you for being here. And I love you so much.
Miigwech Chickadee. Bujo, Pepa Moitum of Dishnikas, Moose Dutam, Iskatewizaagegan Dunji. As Chickadee had spoke to earlier, as part of our protocols, we introduce ourselves in our Indigenous language, in the Anishinaabe language. And you know, second to those protocols is we give our thanks to the people that are organizing, that brought us here together here. And we give thanks to the, for the reason that we come together. Just before I do all of those, I just wanted to acknowledge some of the people that are sitting out here today. I wanted to acknowledge some of the grandmothers that are sitting in the back here, if they could stand up. And just wanted to acknowledge some of the work that they do. Josephine and Judy, if you're still here, could you stand up? And just wanted to give my thanks and acknowledgement to both of you, our grandmothers here. Too tall to talk. What I wanted to share and why I wanted to give thanks and acknowledgement to them is that they're truly representative of some of the powerfulness that our Anishinaabe Kwik, our Aboriginal women have. Josephine Mandaman has walked thousands and thousands and thousands of kilometers around lakes, you know, to the seas, along rivers, to give that thanks to water, to Nibe. So I wanted to acknowledge her work that she's done doing that. I participated in one of the walks that was conducted a number of years ago that came from the northern route. And we walked from, I believe, Winnipeg down to Fort Frances area, just to acknowledge and raise awareness of what water means to us as Anishinaabe people. I also wanted to acknowledge Judy De Silva yesterday as they were doing a water ceremony in the territory of Grassy Narrows to look at some of the effects that have happened from a derailment of oil and that had happened just recently to some of our relatives in Ontario, where there was a derailment in their area. And you know, you have stories from families saying they could feel it when they breathe, but yet everybody was telling them it was fine. So there's impacts that are happening like that, and it's why we come together to share some of the concerns that we have. In that acknowledgement, I'd like to also thank Andrea and everybody that was part of bringing us here today, and my colleagues and my good friends. I'm honored to be here to speak with you today. It truly is a privilege. One of the things I wanted to share and add on some of the things that Chickadee had mentioned earlier today was part of the teachings that we learn, you know, at a young age as Anishinaabe people of this land. for women and for young girls, what happens in our community is we're taught what water means and that water is life. When we were probably 5 or 6 years old, they talk about, you know, that water is life, you know, in its simplest form. When a baby is born, the baby is carried in water, and that the water breaks to clean that path for that life to come, and that's for all of us. So that shows what that importance and what that means for water and how much it is a part of each of us, that we all need that to be here today. Not just us, but everything that we live here among. Not just us here today, but us and our children, our great-grandchildren, our great-grandchildren's grandchildren. And so when we think about some of the things that are happening right now, that's what we keep in mind. What kind of place are we going to be leaving those children? And what can we do now, today, to ensure that there's a place here for them, that we did what we could to make sure a good life for our future. In our language, we call that Minogumatazuin. One of the other things I just wanted to share was that as Anishinaabe people, we have another set of, I guess we call them laws that we live by. There's a law of creation that everything set in this world is set in a specific way for all of our existence. We call that Manitou Anakanagewin. A second law that I wanted to mention was Aki Anakanagewin, which means laws of the land. That means things are set in a certain way for everything to function. You think of the rivers, the bodies of water, like your mother's veins, and so that's why we call it Mother Earth. The third of that I wanted to mention was laws of the people, and that for us as people to do anything, we need to make sure that we're acknowledging and respecting both of those other laws. That laws of the people, we can't interfere or change things of creation of the land, because it's not just about us as people, that there's specific reasons for everything and how they are set that we must abide by. There are certain ways and ceremonies that we conduct ourselves to see how to communicate. So those areas are just some of the foundations of our sovereignty and of our nationhood that I wanted to speak to. So in some of our teachings, what the water means to us is that it's life. And that those laws are created there for a specific reason. When you're looking at law of creation, it means that in those oil sands, that's where that oil is meant to be. When you start changing things and rerouting, you know, different mechanisms, you're changing the veins of Mother Earth, and that's not how things are meant to be. When you start taking things from a different area, there's impacts to that. I just wanted to acknowledge in the PowerPoint the mention of the black snake, that our elders talk about that as well and shared with us a number of different times of what that black snake means, and the vision that came along with that is that a young girl is standing by the lake, but it's not a lake. It's all black. And that little girl is saying, "Why did you do that?" Sorry. I have a 2-year-old daughter, and so when we share that story, that's who I see. And we all have, you know, children and grandchildren and people that we love. I don't think I've ever cried when I spoke before. So, thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for bearing with my emotion on the issue. So I ask that you know, when we're talking about those types of things, we're all connected in that way. We're all connected to our children, to our families, and to our future. And it's stresses like that bring us together. The importance of water, of life, and of our family. And all of these issues that we talked about, I had the opportunity to to find new family, to find other brothers and sisters to work with that can share our same concern. And that's why I wanted to acknowledge some of the grandmothers that are here today, my friends that are here, and all my new friends that are also here with us today. Wanted to give that thanks. Because it's when we come together that we can be stronger, to unite against things like this. And like my friend said just earlier, there's things like this that we can oppose together for all of our future. What I also wanted to just mention while we're here is the name of our community, Iskatewizaagegan, and what that means to our people. That in our language translated, there's a story behind what that means, and it's a shallow lake. And this water that we have here today, that's where that came from. And so there was a change over 100 years ago to bring water from Shoal Lake, where we live, where our home is, where we have been since time immemorial. So I'm here to share today that, and what I'm also here to share today is that, you know, when you're drinking water, when you turn on your taps, and every day that you use water, give that thanks and acknowledgement to the Anishinaabe people that have been impacted by the change of water that has happened in our territory, so that we can also share that life with all the people here in Winnipeg. In moving forward, some of the things that we've been planning to do is have water walks, is to share some of the teachings that we've been given, to share with others the opportunity that we have before us to work with one another. We as Indigenous people have also been coordinating events that will be coming up. There's a water walk that we'll be having in August that we wanted to mention as well, where we'll be out creating awareness, and it will be in the Treaty 3 territory from Eagle Lake to Shoal Lake. So if you see us out there, if there's an opportunity, we'll also be having a gathering in Shoal Lake to speak to some of these things, to speak to some of the concerns, and to talk about how we can begin to work together and address some of the issues that our elders had spoke to, and start to raise that awareness about what water means and how the diversion of water from our community has also impacted the lives of our people. So I just wanted to share that with you all today. Wanted to thank everybody for inviting us and very honored for the opportunity to speak and to share. If anybody has any questions, that'll probably be later, but you know, thank you again for the opportunity, and miigwech.
Thank you, Fawn, for your kind words of love. As a mother, we all love our children. As a father, we all hope and pray for good things for our families. So, miigwech, speaking from a mother's point of view. So, we have an amazing woman here who's asked me not to read out her bio. She said it's too much. So I said I would ad lib. No. But I think everybody knows who she is. She's been around for a while. She is the national chairperson of the Council of Canadians and chairs the board of Washington-based Food and Water Watch. Her name is Maude Barlow, and she said, please don't read any of my bio. I'm not listening. But it's okay. It's my territory. I can say what I want to say. She's also a member of the board of the San Francisco-based International Forum on Globalization and a counselor with the Hamburg-based World Future Council. Maude is the recipient of 11 honorary doctorates as well as many awards. In 2008-2009, she served as a senior advisor on water to the 63rd President of the United Nations General Assembly, and was a leader in the campaign to have water recognized as human right by the UN. She's also the author of a dozen reports as well as 17 books, including her latest, New Future, Protecting Water for People and Planet Forever. Welcome, Maude Barlow.
Well, thank you very, 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 very much, everybody, for being here, particularly on this gorgeous night. It's the first kind of warm summer night, so we're really deeply moved. Chickadee from Treaty One, thank you so much for your beautiful introduction. Chief Wapioke, Fawn, our friend, my friend, I thank you for your moving statement, and I want to tell you that Margaret Atwood said, "The world seen clearly is seen through tears. Why ask me then what is wrong with my eyes?" I mean, your tears were a gift to all of us, and you expressed what everyone in this room is feeling, the fear that we're feeling about what we're seeing around us and how sometimes it feels impossible to fight it. But we do, and we will win this one. Thank you to the drummers. I also want to add my voice to welcome and say love to Josephine Mandeman and Judy De Silva. These are two tremendous women who have just been incredible leaders in our movement. An honor to be on this panel with Eric and Andrea and Ben. Thank you for coming all the way to share this story. You could see how people were moved by it. I do want to thank Mary and the council chapter and all of the people who put tonight on. And just a quick shout out to Robert Chernomas, who's on our board and is over here, and Shirley Lord, a former board member. And a little shout out, an embarrasser, to former Senator Mira Spivak, who is here in the front row, and you might not know, was the person who kept bovine growth hormone out of Canada. Thank you, Mira. That's true. The Senate has done some very good things, and you were one of them. So, okay, I want to talk a little bit about water. We know, and Andrea talked about some of the concerns we have about climate, and of course they're enormously linked. But what we're learning more recently is that when we talk to climate people, tend to talk about water. They tend to talk about water as it is impacted by greenhouse gas emission fuel climate change. But what we're really learning is that when we remove water from water retentive landscapes, or when we remove vegetation from water retentive landscapes, we dry up the land. It changes the local hydrologic cycle. And the way we are taking water from where it belongs and the way we are destroying ecosystems and watersheds is actually one of the major causes of climate chaos. That's what's happened in California. They have enough water in California. They've engineered it through aqueducts and pipelines and so on, and much of it going to the cities, much of it going to produce luxury food goods for the world. They produce 80% of the world's almonds. And so we're not thinking about, put it a different way, we see water as a resource for our pleasure and profit. And we've lost touch, and you heard tonight how important it is, how First Nations have not lost touch, but most in our society have lost touch with water as the essential element of a living ecosystem that gives us life. So I want to think about water as we contemplate Energy East. I took my favorite walk yesterday through the Forks, and I love that area where the Assiniboine meets the Red, and where people have been assembling for at least 600 years, and who knows how much? Sorry, 6,000 years, and who knows how much longer than that? And the beauty of the area, the migrating birds and the geese are coming back, and it's just, and the mud was everywhere. I could walk back with muddy shoes and just felt invigorated. And I thought, if there's a spill of this dilbit in this community, in this area, it will just do such incredible devastation. We're not talking about conventional energy here. We're talking about diluted bitumen, which is that tarry stuff, that clay-like oil that comes from the tar sands and isn't able to move through pipelines by itself, so they have to dilute it with chemicals like benzene and toluene and other liquid chemicals to make it move through the pipeline. And when it spills, and Andrea is right, it's extremely important for us to say when it spills. It's not a case of if, even with state-of-the-art pipelines, but for sure with a pipeline that's in some places over 40 years old and been converted, there will be spills. When it spills, it acts differently than conventional crude in water. We know this because there have been several spills now of this diluted bitumen or dilbit. One was in Kalamazoo, Michigan, where 3.8 million liters were spilled. And 5 years later, it's kind of $1.5 billion later, they're not able to clean it up. The chemicals vaporize in the air and they make people in community sick. Ben has been there. He says they've either moved the people out or the people who've left, who've stayed are sick and dying. And the tarry substance falls to the bottom, where it's almost impossible to recover it. So we are talking about a new, and I'm not saying that what happened out off Vancouver, the city of Vancouver yesterday or 2 days ago was all right, but we're talking about a different kind of substance here. We're talking about the most dangerous form of energy in the world, moving through, as I say, 40-year-old converted pipelines that are running right along the Assiniboine, under the Red. 2 meters, this pipeline in Winnipeg runs 2 meters under the aqueduct that takes clean water from Shoal Lake and brings it to provide drinking water for the people of Winnipeg. Two meters under the aqueduct. And we met with city officials and they explained to us that it's a clay-like substance in the aqueduct. And we are very worried about what would happen if, obviously, any kind of spill, but what would happen in terms of destroying the reservoir here. And don't forget now, we have a not only a very old pipeline, but what we're learning is that the spill, because of the amount of diluted bitumen that this pipeline would be producing, in 10 minutes it would spill a million liters of this stuff into our water systems. We visited St. Norbert today where there was an explosion of the gas pipeline in 1996, and in spite of the fact that the company says we've never had an explosion in water, there was an explosion in the LaSalle water system, and they were explaining to us, the local people who live there, that had it been diluted bitumen, that stuff would go down the LaSalle River right into the Red River and on into the city of Winnipeg. Now this is all for an export pipeline. Andrea said this, but I want to really hone in on this, because what the company and the government of Canada will tell you is that we're producing Western energy for Eastern Canadians. This is not true. The vast majority of this energy will be going to put on barges and ships and shipped away in either the St. John, New Brunswick port, or if they do build other ports. Not much of it is going to stay in Canada because we do not have the refining capacity to deal with this. You're also going to hear another argument that it makes, this is better, everybody says, well, it's better than rail. Look at what happened in Lac-Megantic. But it's very important to note that the majority of the energy source being carried in trains in Canada is fracked oil and gas from the Bakken fields. They like the boom and bust nature of using trains because that's the nature of their business. They're not seeking pipelines. It's not a case of either or, it's a case of both. The more you have of the tar sands energy being produced in our country and piped away, the more demand there will be for this sort of dual system. So it's very important that we don't buy into this system or this argument. We don't want either one of them. They're double jeopardy and they're both bad. Now, I just want to say that we're dealing with this against a backdrop of a federal government that has destroyed all of our environmental protections for water in this country. They gutted the Fisheries Act, they gutted the Navigable Waters Protection Act, they gutted the Environmental Assessment Act, which dropped 3,000 environmental assessments at the time. They changed the mandate for the National Energy Board, which basically now will either rubber stamp everything that they're told to rubber stamp, and or if they ever dared not, Cabinet can still override and say, well, thank you very much for your opinion, but this is what we decided to do. Stephen Harper has tried to turn our country into a petrostate. He's removed every obstacle possible that might get in the way of this happening quickly, including laws that protect, could have protected our water, including going after environmental groups and communities, calling us terrorists. I've got a new report out called Blue Betrayal, which is on our website, canadians.org, which tells how systematically they have gone after our water. So I think it's very important for us to look at this larger picture of this pipeline against not only what it would do when you stand down in the Forks at that beautiful place where these two rivers meet, but what it would do to our ability to protect our water across the country. We're talking over 1,000 waterways between where the pipeline would start and where the pipeline would end in St. John, New Brunswick. And again, just against the global picture then, Ben talked about it, and I cannot strongly enough say to you that we are a planet running out of clean water. We were taught as children that couldn't happen. We were taught there's a cycle, hydrologic cycle, and there's an exact amount of water and it can't go anywhere. And so you can't destroy it. Maybe we can pollute it, but we can clean it up. But that's not so. We are placing such stress on our limited water sources that there are parts of the world that are running out. They use the term drought, but it's actually not the correct term. It's like mining groundwater. It's like a gold mine company comes in and it mines the gold till it's gone and then they move on. Just a few quick snapshots. China, half the rivers in China have disappeared since 1990. I don't mean polluted, I mean they're gone. They don't know where they went, they're just simply gone. Ben talked about the Ogallala. The Department of Agriculture said 2 years ago that the Ogallala will be gone in our lifetime. That's a statement they made, not me. California, you've read the stories about the, you know, 1 year left of water, and there's dispute back and forth whether it's 1 year or 2 years, but without rain and without a renewed snowpack, that is a state in deep, deep trouble. I spent a fair amount of time in Brazil because it's a place I find close to my heart, but I'm watching what's happening there, and to me it's the most important story in the world. Because until very recently, Brazil was considered to be the country in the world that had the most water. And now they're in severe drought. The city of Sao Paulo, greater Sao Paulo, has 20 million people. They don't even know if they have water for a year. Their aquifers and their water sources and their reservoirs are dried up. And in many, many parts of the city, you're only allowed to turn on the tap between 5 and 6 in the morning and then turn it on again at between 10 and 11 at night. And it doesn't come on hard. I mean, it just dribbles out, and you better do as much as you can with what comes out of those taps, because that's what you're going to have. Why has this happened in Brazil? Because they cut the Amazon rainforest down. And what we now know is when you cut rainforest, when you cut forest, when you take away grassland, you take away the ability of the hydrologic cycle to work. Rainforests create massive amounts of vapor that travel, they call them flying rivers, thousands of kilometers away. And that has provided marvelous rain for all the hydrologic health that Brazil has needed forever. They've never had these kind of droughts in recorded history, and now they're running out. So if I say to you that I am worried, I'm going to say to you that there's no place on earth, including people who live on a beautiful lake called Lake Winnipeg, or those of us who live, you know, anywhere in sort of near the Great Lakes, there's no place on earth that's free from the threat that our collective abuse is doing to water. And we have to bring in what I call a new water ethic, which is to say that every single thing that we do and every policy we adopt must ask the question, what's the impact on water? And if it's not good, if it's not acceptable, then we have to go back to the drawing boards. And this means a total readjustment of our relationship to Mother Earth, putting Mother Earth at the center of all of our policy and our behavior. We're building a wall of opposition to the Energy East pipeline. You're going to hear TransCanada say to you, it's too late, it's done. It is not done. They've only applied for their license. We can say no at many, many points along the way. We've seen great resistance. 50 municipalities in Quebec have either said no or said go back to the drawing boards, give us more information. Both the governments of Ontario and Quebec have set up some conditions. There's rising opposition, as Andrea said, on the imports in St. John. We stopped Kakuna. The opposition was fierce. The company said they weren't going to budge, and they blinked. Over 2,000 applications have been put to the National Energy Board that really wants to limit who they hear from and how. And there's a rising tide of First Nations opposition that is, in my opinion, the most exciting and the most important opposition happening across the whole line of Energy East, and which we're going to work with, whom we're going to support and show solidarity with, because it's an incredibly important alliance for us to build here. And I just want to end by saying, look, this is the wrong model. All the many reasons to say no to Energy East, it will put billions of dollars into a fossil fuel future. There are countries in the world that are going fossil fuel free. Germany has dates and targets to end fossil fuel dependence, but that's because they decided to do this and they put money and time and energy and political will behind it. Well, we have a government that says we only see one future for energy in this country, and that's more fossil fuels and the most deadly of all the kinds of fossil fuels that you can think of, including more fracking. That's the wrong future for us. But if we lock ourselves into a pipeline like this, it will lock future governments, future generations into this project, because it's going to cost so much money and it'll be so hard to move to the kind of project that we need. We're cutting the arteries, we're stopping the arteries to the tar sands, which will not be able to grow if we are able to cut these pipelines and stop them. They simply will not have the facility to ship this stuff around the world. So we have to stop this pipeline. And I feel very, very hopeful. I'm quite excited about this. I've been in many, many campaigns in my life, and I know when one's not a winner and when one is a winner, and I think this one we can win. I believe that hope is a moral imperative. We have to get up every morning and take a deep breath and say, this is the gift of our time on earth, is to have a challenge like this, you know, to, as you've heard so many people say tonight, to leave the clean air and clean water to the next generation, because they have the same right to drink clean water and breathe clean air that we do. We can stop this pipeline working together, and we can say to TransCanada and the Energy East pipeline, you shall not pass. Thank you so much.
I'm speaking on behalf of the Wilderness Committee and also the Manitoba Energy Justice Coalition as local organizations who are working to stop Energy East. I'm Manitoba Campaign Director for the Wilderness Committee. You might remember the Wilderness Committee from such campaigns as Stop Logging in Provincial Parks and Say No to Oil by Rail Through Churchill. So far tonight, we've had very inspirational words spoken, and it's really a tough act to follow. At the end of every event that we run, the big question is, what do we do? What do the people in the room do? You've been given the reason to act by all the things that you've been told. I want to give you the hope that we can change this and a path forward. In the 1990s, governments around the world committed to protecting more of the environment. The Endangered Spaces campaign was run for a decade. Every year that this was run, there was polling done in each province across the country. And without fail, Manitobans were the most supportive of protecting wilderness, in many cases nearly 10 points higher than every other province. And what this says, that back then, Manitobans got it. This is wonderful news. This is the start of where we move on our next campaigns. This week, Climate Action Network Canada released polling numbers on Energy East. The summary that made headlines, you may have seen, said that 61% of Canadians say protecting the climate is more important than pipelines and tar sands. And that's wonderful news. That's why we're here. Canadians are realizing the need to act on climate. Now, digging deeper into the poll data, I was pointed out that the hope that I was talking about, that this room tonight needs, the data shows that Manitobans really get it, that we have to act on climate. Not just 61%, but 78% of Manitobans polled said that protecting the climate is more important than pipelines. So it means that we're not alone. Although we have this many people in the room tonight, thousands of Manitobans are thinking the exact same thing we're doing. So in 2013, when the audacious plan to ship oil by rail through Churchill was publicized, the Manitoba government was silent. For a month, as an international swell of opposition to putting our northern lands and waters at risk grew, Manitobans told their governments to stop the plan. We directed hundreds of letters to the government, and after a month, the Manitoba government came out against the plan. 30 days of pressure, and the Manitoba government said no to oil by rail through Churchill. I know there's some representatives of the Manitoba government in this audience somewhere tonight. The thing that's important here is that the way they said no to oil by rail through Hudson Bay, to Hudson Bay and through Hudson Bay, was that pipelines and railways are considered federal jurisdiction, meaning that this federal government, the one who's cut all of our environmental laws, was the one who would make the decisions on it. However, the construction of anything in Manitoba requires provincial building permits. In Churchill, the Manitoba government exercised their authority, and some would say their responsibility, and made it known that they would not approve any building proposals that were needed to move oil from the rail to ships. Exactly. Energy East requires the construction of 9 new pumping stations. Now, the Manitoba government so far has been silent on Energy East. But we have demonstrated already in the last couple of years that the Manitoba government can be moved. We've seen from the polling numbers this week that Manitobans overwhelmingly want this project stopped. So our action, very simple, it's the card. It's on the chair in front of you, everyone has one, and if the one on your chair isn't enough, because you each probably want to take 10 of them home to share with your friends, family, and relatives, your knitting group, your chess club, your ball hockey team. The card simply says, "Dear Premier of Manitoba, climate change is already affecting Manitoba," and sums up by saying, "I urge the Manitoba government to deny approval for construction of the Energy East pipeline." So when we look at the maps, it's really simple. Manitobans overwhelmingly say no to Energy East. The Manitoba government has decision-making power on this pipeline, and if Manitobans, if the people in this room and across the province say no, then we stop this pipeline, period. The cleanup stuff that I'd like to do for the organizations, local actions, the Manitoba Energy Justice Coalition has a table in the back, the Wilderness Committee has a table in the back. Stop by, sign up on our email lists, pick up some more of our information. Go visit noenergyeastmanitoba.org. There's a... The Water Walk as well. There's a photo booth in the back. Take a picture at the photo booth. There is a July 4th event that I can't tell you about, but it's happening on July 4th. And there is a volunteer event in St. Norbert on April 26th, so anybody who wants to get involved with Stopping Energy East should show up in St. Norbert at 1 p.m. And that information can be found at the back. And so that's what I have to say. Thank you.